The reason to go to Sweden was the Scorpions were, you know, they didn't want to be in the same place again and again. So we were up for another adventure. And we heard that the famous band ABBA had built a brand new studio in Stockholm, the Polar Studios. And we knew also that Led Zeppelin had produced their last album there. So since we're all Zeppelin fans, we thought the combination is great. Let's go to Stockholm. And so we were there in the springtime of 1983. And we started recording and things were like, we were off to a slow start there in a way. And then it turned out that Francis, the bass player, had some difficulties with his tendonitis. And so he couldn't really play. And Herman was also in not his best shape. And so we decided to bring in Bobby Rondinelli on drums and Jimmy Bain on bass, just in order to be able to continue. Those days we worked late hours, until like 4 a.m. or something. Now we know that the last 4 hours don't really do the trick. But it was Stockholm. It's high up north. So we came out of the studio most of the time and the sun was like blasting in your eyes. It was a crazy time. I think we spent there 6 weeks and basically recorded nothing.
In Stommeln, in those days, there was a pub next door to the studio, Marlene's Pub, starving musicians, you have to go to eat something sometime in the day. And this was a place where we went in the evening, I had some dinner, and something. But many times after dinners, we stayed there and we were just having a party with, we could just get lost, And then at 5 a.m, Dieter Dirks went, "Come on, guys, now we go in the studio and now we nail it. Now we nail it, we do the best version of this song we ever played." Of course we didn't, but every time we believed, yes, this is it. And just to learn the next day, it was all crap. But we had a good time there. And I remember also in those years that sometimes we were hanging out with Rory Gallagher, a wonderful guitar player who we were touring with in our early 70s. And he spent some time there in the Dirk Studios recording as well. Sometimes we were hanging out with him. We just had the best time of our lives. I can't remember if it was me or Herman or whoever came up with the title "Love It First Thing." It was such a great title, "Love It First Sight," "Love It First Thing," and so writing the lyrics for "Rock You Like a Hurricane," I put the title in the song as well, to make that connection. And I always liked the photography of Helmut Newton, when I called him, he was interested. And in those days, I went to lots and lots of these bookstores where you can see all those fabulous artworks and photo books, and lots of stuff also from Helmut Newton and other great artists and photographers. And I found an image also from one famous photographer, which I showed the band in the studio. And it was like a guy leaning over a lady, tattooing her back, we thought, this is Love It First Sting. This looks so cool. This would be great. But we couldn't get this artwork. But everybody in the band agreed on this shot, And when we went to Paris for this session with Helmut Newton, he shot the band. And when you take a look at it, in the inner sleeve, it's the band walk all dressed up in leather. This was an idea from Helmut Newton, shooting the band, walking towards the camera, like his famous shots from the five blonde nudes. Those nude ladies walking towards the camera. It's a very famous Helmut Newton shot.
I think it's only four.
It's only four? Okay.
Mm, but we were five.
Yeah, okay. But anyway, so we did this session in Paris, and after the band left, I stayed with him.
Klaus pushed him more and more and more, and then he said, okay, I make something for you. And then he made this version, and then we took this one, because it's perfect arty-wise. It's amazing.
What came out was just fantastic.
The guitar collection became bigger and bigger throughout the years, especially after every US tour. I came home with a couple of new ones meaning old ones. And at that time, I started looking more into acoustic guitars. There was a time when Ovation made the only acoustic guitar with pickups that you could use on stage with a loud PA without having a feedback. These days you can put in modern pickup systems in any type of acoustic guitar. But back then it was not so easy. You didn't have a great variety to choose from. And so I was looking into like old Gibsons and stuff and started collecting acoustic guitars too. I bought a great Telecaster in New York in Candy Apple Red. I still have that. That's the one that starts the song Wind of Change and many others, but I have it since 1983, and it was the reason for me to start a whole collection in that color. So I have all Fender instruments, some of them double, in that color, including all the basses and the Jaguars and the Mastercasters and everything. And that was the initial guitar. Great guitar, I still have it. It has a very like sensitive tone and a great vibe to it.
I bought a guitar from a Mr. From the band called Lake, Alex Conte, and this was a 58 Flying V. This guitar, he told me, even Eric Clapton was very interested to buy it. But in this case, Alex Conti, he was still into making music and I always told him, I said, look, when you will sell this, I'm really want to buy it. So, and he said, okay. And I remember once I get a phone call, I said, all right, I buy this. And this guitar, it's the best guitar. The wood is fantastic. The pickups are great. And this was the guitar I played Still Loving You on. There were also the guitar I was playing with City Nights. A solo of Still Loving You, the solo of Big City Nights. Every guitar inspires you, which comes new. That's you pick the guitar and then somehow you compose one of the songs, a new song, because of the sound of the guitar, of the history of the guitar.
Bad Boys Running Wild has a guitar intro that I think I've been asked, it feels like 100,000 times. How do you do that? And I had to show to many people. It's a great way of opening the album, because we recorded the song without it first. And then I thought about something. The opening of the album needs to be special. People put it on turntable at the time, and you gotta go, wow, what is that? So I came up with it actually on an acoustic guitar, sitting on an island in the North Sea, thinking about what can one do that hasn't been done before. And there was that one. So it starts quite spectacular. Bad boys,
Bad Boys Running Wild would actually describe perfectly the situation from the band 1984, because we were bad boys running wild. And this is all I'm going to say about this thematic, okay? Otherwise, I blame everything on me.
It's a great song. It's no, I remember I was moving houses. I went from the normal flat to a house. I found a house and I was so happy. And I played in one of the rooms which I couldn't put furniture in because I had no time. And there was a great acoustic in it. And I played there and composed there, Bad Boys Running Wild, Rock You Like a Hurricane.
It's a great song. We played it live on stage for many, many years, until only recently. It's a great song. I love it. Out in the streets, dogs are on the run, pimps are all in heat. Out in the streets, slaves are all around you, dirty rats are on their way. They control you and it makes you pay. Here I am, rock you like a hurricane.
Well, this is another true story of mine from the lyrical point of view. Krauss had this great hook, then here I am, rock you like a hurricane, so I basically wrote the verses. It's early morning, the sun comes out, last night was shaking and pretty loud. That describes perfectly my situation at the time in the 80s on the road. Woke up in the morning, 5 in the morning or 6, you put the curtain aside, there's the sunshine, you didn't sleep, the whole night was taking drugs and drinking, you know. And you look to your right and you go, hey, what happened, you know? And suddenly you realize it's morning, it's early morning, the sun comes out, last night was shaking and pretty loud. My cat is purring and scratches my skin. So what is wrong with another sin? So those lines you can also create if you live that life, if you live that moment. And I wrote it immediately after that moment.
That's an iconic song. I know I'm using this term iconic many times now, but that's what it is. You know, it's really, I mean, it's about a young band on tour in America and to see America through a tour bus window, every day, new city, new place, everywhere screaming crazy, excited fans.
There were 9 times changing the lyrics because it's very difficult to write the verses to "Here I am, rocking like a hurricane." So, but then Klaus and Hermann came together and Dieter said, "Hey guys, let's, you guys sit together and maybe you can get something out." And Hermann was always a big fan of double meaning. This was his first thing. Double meaning, that's the one. So, and I think that's the point. This double meaning with the pitched kind of, the bitch is hungry, she needs to tell, so give her inches and feel her well. That's perfect for Rock You Like a Hurricane. So everything else, I remember 8 times I said, no, I don't like it. This time I said, amazing.
The backwards snare effect on Rock You Like a Hurricane in verse 3 is an invention of Tony Bongiovi. Because we send him the song to, which is a Hit Factory, where he works in New York, and he is the uncle of John Bon Jovi, who named himself John Bon Jovi later, and he was running around making the tea in that studio. So he invented that effect for the snare drum.
It's early morning, the sun comes out, this night was shaking, really loud.
We learned from you know, from the late 70s when we went to America for the first time. We learned our deal quick, how it is and what it takes to entertain 20,000 people in a big arena, you know. That's what we learned in America. It's not all about the music, it's about the show, it's about the communication with the fans, this interacting kind of thing. And I think that's what we learned in those early years. And by the mid-80s, when we went on tour with Love at First Thing, we were really on top of the game, you know, and Rock You Like a Hurricane became very fast. It became the rock anthem, and it found its place in the set. It became the encore, the top of the show.
The Cage, the Leopard, the Black Panther, all happening in the video of Rock You Like a Hurricane, which we shot in London with David Mallet, a very famous director. And, you know, great ideas from him or the makeup artists. The girls with that red stripe makeup across the eyes, across the face. Very, very good video.
It was a breathtaking video because it was outstanding for us at the time. And it was running on MTV up and down the whole time because it was good.
The song supported the video, but the video supported the song. So it was like, it was great. And my guitar solo was voted in America top 10 of the greatest guitar solos of all time. And so this song has everything.
Well, I'm Leaving You has a pop touch, you know, but a very nice one. It's that song has a very nice structure.
I'm Leaving You is also interesting because our drummer James Kotick, one of the favorite songs. Yeah, it's also something which, you know, if you're on the right track and when I in a new house, you're enjoying very much the new way of living. And then you fiddle around, you play, you're coming from this blackout tour, you have so many, you're full of, like a full bottle of creativity. So, and then you start really doing so many things. As I said, meditation, composing, meditation, composing. There is a lot of time in this maybe 18 hours or 14 hours. I was composing from the morning into the evening. So maybe in between, I don't know, eating and whatever. So, but mostly I was working to get even better and write better songs. And there is some of this kind of stuff where I was by myself surprised.
Yeah, I remember the video for I'm Leaving You. We had the first, we're in touch with the director, the record company had chosen, or the management. We were still on tour in Japan, and the guy happened to be in Tokyo, or he flew over, I can't remember, but we met in Japan, we're discussing it, and he had the idea of the baseball female youth team in an old school bus, American school bus, and don't ask me what the story is, but it looks nice, you know? So we were surrounded by these really cute girls and we had a fantastic time shooting videos, you know, because there were always like beautiful girls around, you know, that was the basis for every rock and roll video, you know, that was priority number one.
You won't be able to
play
the solo, but I want you to play it.
Oh, okay. I know what's happening.
No, give me Tracy. Tracy Small.
He is going for the third one. He's going
to go like this.
Yeah.
Anymore.
He's going to do like that. So one, give me that I come back to love you. Give me your mind till I come back to love you.
It was in New Jersey. And Richie Sambora came by. I remember that, because he said, I live around the corner. He called me, because we were on tour together at the time, and we had like a short break, and said, this is where I live. And so they came by. I think John Bon Jovi came by also. And was he there also?
Yeah, Johnny came by as well.
So he came by as well. And so because they are from New Jersey, and home for a few days, and then we continued, because they were supporting us at the time.
What do you think, which time it will be on MTV?
Depends on MTV. I would imagine it'll be on, I would imagine they'd want it quickly. Yeah. It also depends on Polygram. You know, yes. At MTV, it's who they're pushing
depends
to get
on. Depends
on
the, you know, when the singer comes out, too. Yeah. You know, Mix will be ready by tomorrow, and then they have, you know, to...
Everybody has always got to get it on MTV immediately. Yeah. So.
Okay, guys.
Okay.
See you later.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Coming home, it's also, you know, if you are on the right road, you're driving like crazy. So coming home is a part of it.
Coming home is a song where we tried for the first time, like to have like a very melodic, slow, almost like you start dreaming kind of intro. And then all of a sudden, all hell breaks loose and it turns into a high speed song with a very catchy melody. And I remember at a radio station in, you know, we have to imagine America, because the 80s and Love at First Sting is about America, and we spent so many months in America. It's always there. It's so US connected. We were at a midnight radio show live in Sacramento with a very crazy DJ with a red beard, and he cranked that song. And he blew the speakers in the studio. I mean, they had back then they had speakers of this size, and he turned it up because he listened to that slow part, which is very much lower in volume, already on maximum level. But then it went poof. He blew the fuse, and then he started talking, and somebody came in and fixed it. And it didn't matter at the time. I think the interview like lasted 3 hours. We spent the night at the radio station. Sometimes we took over as DJs too.
Yeah, same thrill was nothing else like making another rock song in a situation like Now and Can't Get Enough. So I don't know whether it's good as the other guys, but it was. It's a spice. When I composed the stuff, including the melody on top of it, the riff, and the melody, so I felt already very good about it and called Klaus and said, Klaus, you listen to it, and sometimes over the phone, and he goes, oh yeah, that's fantastic, great.
I connected very, very much with the time when it came out in America and we heard it for the first time on the radio. There is a difference, I'm telling you, when you listen to your music in the studio or when you listen to it, let's say, on a German radio, or if you listen to it on the radio in Paris, or if you listen to it in a convertible car in California. There is a difference. It's the same piece of music, but you sense it completely different each and every time.
When we spent some time in Tokyo, and we all went out, when we played Tokyo, we all went out after the show to the Biblos, which was a fancy club there.
I remember we came in the morning back from a club, and somehow I was opening the curtains, which housekeeping was closing before they made the room, and opened the, and there were Tokyo in flames because of the sun comes up, and there were everything red.
Rudolf called me, and it was 5-6 in the morning. I said, Klaus, you got to open the curtain, you know, take a look at this, you know. And it was like the sky, the sun coming up, and it was like, wow, it was amazing.
Out of that, he remembers the song, because when I composed the song, I gave him always the demos, which were very easy done. You know, we don't want to make it too perfect. But he remembers very much and said, oh, that would be a perfect thing for the lyrics for Big City Nights.
That's a great song with the military kind of drums, you know, and it's also a bit like an early Wind of Change when you talk about the lyrics. It's also like an anti-war song, you know, and on an album with many crazy rock and roll lyrics, you know, this is the one where I try to reflect the way we come from.
We were sitting in this hotel room by listening back to what we did from this song, and by Crossfire, we said, oh, there is something missing. Maybe we need not only one snare doing this beat, we need kind of hundreds of, well, not hundreds, but maybe 20 or 50 snares doing the same thing. We have to double them.
The drums, the snare drum of the military marching kind of sound, Dieter recorded with Herman, I think, 99 tracks that wouldn't have been possible with analog tapes, you know, previously. So they were using the new technology to the fullest.
The Crossfire and the meaning of Crossfire for that song, for the lyrics, it was like we're living in the crossfire, we're living between the East and Western blocks.
In a divided country.
You know, in a divided country, like in the middle of Europe, you know, between the East and Western blocks. And that was, that song was trying to say. I guess Rudolf played Still Lovin' You for the very first time for me around the late 70s. And for some reason, nobody in the band, we didn't connect with the song, you know. It was, we went in the studio, we played the demos, we listened to that demos stuff, and Still Lovin' You was one of them. And it never clicked, really. Maybe the song wasn't finished. Still Lovin' You was like a sleeper, you know.
I played since, even when Uli was still there, in 76, every production I played this, and Klaus was singing, Klaus sings. So, and all the time, okay, great. Uli never wanted to play it because it was too commercial for him.
Whenever Rudolf came up with it, it never ended up on the record.
Then we worked on 1983 for working on Love at First Sting. There, immediately I played this riff again, and immediately a whole band came together.
In 83, I think when we recorded the album, then it clicked.
That song was not easy. So, and I remember when we recorded parts in Stockholm, in the ABBA studios, we played this song like crazy. We tried to make it happen. And late, sooner or later, we got the song in the right form. The time was right.
I remember I wrote the lyrics in a, walking in a snowstorm without a piece of paper, you know? And I mean, it's like you have a song and you try to, I always try to find the words to Rudolf's songs where I try to express what he said with his guitar, with his playing, with the composition. I try to make the words and make it fit like a glove, you know? Walking in this snowstorm, it was a beautiful atmosphere, you know, but I had no piece of paper. So I remember I was like running home and tried to bring it all, put it on a piece of paper.
Nobody thought this could be a hit like this, because it's like with Stairway to Heaven, you know. The inspiration actually was a little bit like Stairway to Heaven, because I always said to myself, okay, I want to maybe write once a song like this.
Oh. It's also one of the most difficult songs to sing, you know, and when we play that song, it's mostly in the encores where it belongs. You know, it's very much connected with my voice, you know, and but you need certain quality in your vocal performance to really nail it.
Still Loving You really has been a huge hit in France, you know, not only throughout the 80s. I think it's the most selling single of all times in France, and the French said it created a baby boom in 84-85. And like 20 years later, I met one of those babies, because she came with the parents to one of our shows, and the parents introduced her. This is our daughter, Sly, Still Loving You. So they named her after the song. And that was quite special. That doesn't happen every day.
It's a very powerful song. When this chorus comes in, it's like, wow, you know, this is a rock band, you know. But it has all the, has this typical Scorpions DNA that, yeah, that makes your hair stand up, you know. This song has it all.
Love at First Sting is definitely one of our most successful albums. I mean, it's got key songs like Rock You Like a Hurricane and Still Loving You.
Well, Love at First Sting is for me then also an album which made the status with Rock You Like a Hurricane, and then that song made the big difference, because Rock You Like a Hurricane was the first big hit we had in the United States. It was top 10 on the Billboard charts for weeks and weeks and weeks. And we could see it everywhere we played now. All our shows were sold out, not only one day, sometimes one or two or three days, you know. So this is headliner status, so we enjoyed our lives as rock stars.
It is a step up in terms of success from Blackout, but I would put Blackout and Love Drive on number one. They can't all not all be on number one. For me, that's number two.
This album shows the whole spectrum, the whole artistic DNA of this band, you know, in the most powerful way, which is Rock You Like a Hurricane on one side, Big City Nights, and Still Loving You on the other side, you know, which is also like an iconic song. Both of them are, you know. So this album should be a one with a golden crown on top.
A one. It's, a one. A one.